Thank you very much for to everyone for joining this side event of the UN Water Conference on the today, the 23rd of March, about supporting self-supply. It's 9 o'clock in New York and 2 o'clock here in Wageningen. So I think it's good to start the event. We have a program for about 1.5 hour. During the program, we have 5 different presentations. Firstly, Matthias Saladin will introduce self-supply, the concept, and share some data. And then John Cherry will share on the groundwater and groundwater problems and make a link to self-supply. Then we have a presentation from Colin Andrews from Tieni, who will share on the deep bed farming method, which Tieni is promoting and applying in Malawi and other countries. As fourth presentation, we have Martin Fischer from Kickstart International, talking about the low-cost water pumps they work with and how it makes a difference for farmers. And the last presentation will be by Henk Holtzlag about supporting self-supply as a way to reach the Sustainable Development Goal 6.1. And then at the end, we have a moderated discussion for about 30 minutes. During the presentations, please feel free to share your comments in the chat and the Q&A. And then the speakers will come back to them, and we will also use it as input for the discussion at the end of the event. So firstly, we will start with an introduction to self-supply by Matthias Saladin, who is the program coordinator of SCAT Foundation and leader of the theme self-supply within the Rural Water Supply Network. And he has been engaged in the water sector for over 20 years, most of it related to strengthening local actors to provide better services in WASH. So, Matthias, the floor is yours, and thank you very much for being available.
Thank you, Reinier. And thank you all of the people being here, listening to us and to this really wonderful lineup of speakers. I feel very honored to be able to introduce a concept followed by so many people who have done such great work, written important books. It's a true pleasure to be here. I'll be trying to introduce the topic of self-supply so that we have a common ground of what we want to discuss. As you can see here on the first slide, actually the picture is by Sally Sutton, another great author and person who has done a lot of work on self-supply. I'll give the reference to the book later. The picture is from her book. And the title of my introduction is Self-Supply, A Story of a Billion People. Someone once told me, never give away your message in the title, but I did it on purpose. Part of my message is 1 billion people use self-supply, so it's nothing as small as people think. And that's what I'll be talking about. So maybe to start with, I'll start with the definitions, just very quickly. Commonly, people discussing on the topic of self-supply, they distinguish between self-supply and supported self-supply. While self-supply is really both a coping mechanism and a service provision. So it's a way of delivering water. It doesn't refer to a specific standard or to a specific technology. It's really a mechanism for delivering water. The key part of the key actor in the concept is the private household or the private households who incrementally improve water service. So these are the key words, private households investing largely themselves, sometimes with support, and it's an incremental improvement. So it's not reaching to specific standards. It starts from a very low level and can go up to a very high level. That's one of the definitions that we commonly use. It's also the one we shared on Wikipedia, and I'll be sharing the link later. And related to that is supported self-supply. So that's basically the same mechanism, but with a little bit of support from an external agent. And external agent can be government, NGO, or another actor. As you can see in the pictures here, it really takes a lot of shapes and forms. On the left-hand side, you see a family using an upgraded family well in Zimbabwe, still using bucket and not a rope, but a chain. But with the well-made apron and a safe runoff, and the water quality coming out of that well is actually already quite improved in regards to surface water. But as I mentioned, self-supply can also go all the way up to a deep borehole with the electric pump and storage tank and all the treatment works you want. So it's really up to the individual households of how far they can go and they want to go. I see in the chat box, not everyone can hear me okay. Maybe if several people can't hear me well, please write it in the chat box. Otherwise, I'll keep going. I'll show here a couple of numbers. As I said, self-supply is not small. The private households are actually the biggest donor in the water sector. They're bigger than the development banks, the governments, and the NGOs combined. So it's about 66% of financing in the water sector comes from private households. Globally, more than 1 billion people rely on self-supply, and around 800 million from that billion comes from Asia. And there's countries where particularly high numbers and high percentage of people are using self-supply. And I just listed up here a few examples: Nigeria, United States, Bangladesh, and several other countries in Asia. Self-supply is also very common in Eastern Europe for different reasons. So it's definitely not small, but largely being overlooked in many discussions and events. And that's why we're so happy that this event here today is taking place at the UN World Conference. On the next slide, you see a couple of impressions of how self-supply can look like. And the pictures here are really illustrating the benefits, the multiple pull factors that drive self-supply. So it can be productive use of water in the form of livestock watering, in washing water, in producing, in small livestock, in honey making, brick making, vegetable irrigation. Self-supply really can take a lot of shapes. And even though you see a lot of row pumps here in the pictures, self-supply can take a lot of other shapes as well. It's not one specific pump. As I mentioned, large numbers of self-suppliers are people in Asia, and most of them rely on low-cost hand pumps connected to tube wells. On the next picture, I put up a couple of facts, and those are related to two questions which usually are asked first when we start talking about self-supply. One question is around quality. Is this actually a good quality service? And as I mentioned, self-supply does not refer to a specific quality of service. It's not improved or unimproved. It's really incremental improvements. But an important number is showing here, and that's only rural people in Asia Pacific. That's more than 500 million people, and all of these water sources are considered improved source. And the other question we usually are asked is water from shallow wells or shallow tube wells, is that safe for drinking? And recent research that recently came out is actually showing that in Asia, more people get safe drinking water from self-supply than from piped services. So I know I'm not fully answering the question around quality and safety. I'm just kickstarting here a bit the discussion. Please also feel free to add additional facts or add additional questions in the chat box. By the way, many of the numbers I'm quoting here, they come from a research organization in Australia. Professor Tim Foster has been leading a lot of work in self-supply, and we'll be sharing links to some of his recent publications. Also, a lot of the references that you'll find here in my presentation come from a book. As I mentioned, Sally Sutton wrote a book on self-supply. I will put the link for free downloading on the website, on the chat box here. But just to point out to a few things that are related to self-supply, most of the work around self-supply is indirect. So it's not about putting in a certain number of pumps in a place. It's really making the markets work. That's what self-supply is about. And that's what supporters of self-supply try to enable. It's not always, it's not easy. It has to be context adjusted and also depends how it evolves over time. It's not only about capacity development, but capacity development and training are an important element, but it's also about promotion, about marketing, about getting the policies right, and sometimes about funding. So we do talk about targeted subsidies over a specific time. We do talk about microfinance possibilities and seed money. That gives you a bit of an overview. I hope you now have a clear idea of what we are talking about. On the next slide, I put together a couple of highlights from the self-supply book, but I will not go into that. I'll just keep that up. And once the presentation is shared, you can go back to these. Here on the next slide, you see the link for downloading. I will put that in the chat box. So the self-supply book came out last year, and it's free to download. The last slide is just references. Feel free to use them. We'll also put them in the chat box. Please don't feel overwhelmed by the number of links putting in there. Apart from the books and research that we point out, there's also the option of joining an online community within the Rural Wool Supply Network. That's also free, and everyone is welcome to join. With that, I'm handing over first back to Reinier and then to our wonderful speaker. Thank you so much for being here.
Yes, thank you, Matthias, for the very nice introduction to the theme and the topic of self-supply, and for also showing the scope worldwide. The next speaker is Dr. John Cherry. Who is very much involved in groundwater. He is a research pioneer in the field of groundwater pollution, now known as contaminant hydrology, hydrogeology. And he co-authored the book on groundwater with R.A. Fries, which came out in 1979. He was awarded the Lee Kuan Yew Water Prize in Singapore and also the Stockholm Water Prize in 2020. And now he is involved in an initiative called the Groundwater Project, which is a resource database on groundwater resources. And he will talk about low-cost water wells for eradicating water poverty.
And I'm really pleased to have this opportunity to give a hydrogeological perspective. Groundwater is 99% of all liquid freshwater, and it follows from that then that groundwater is central to the fight against poverty, to food and water security, as reported on by UNESCO last year. Irrigation is draining aquifers to grow mostly wrong types of food for the mostly affluent. 40% of all groundwater is extracted from the 68 largest aquifers of the world, but 1/3 of these are depleted beyond recovery in human time. So there's a water crisis. Groundwater is over-extracted and mismanaged for globalized agriculture. Less pumping of many aquifers is needed. But in the global water crisis, there's a second part, and it's a paradox. Where there's water poverty, groundwater is under-extracted. Many more wells are needed for more than 1 billion rural people in water poverty. Hundreds of millions of people live in hills and mountains engaged in agriculture. Many rely on springs with fecal contamination. Even at improved spring sources, E. coli concentrations are commonly high. At surface, improvements generally do not reduce pathogens because they travel in the shallow subsurface into the spring water. 250 million rural people in India drink spring water. Much of it is likely contaminated. Wells need to be drilled beside the springs to draw deeper uncontaminated water as the water supply. Much of global water poverty is in Africa. water washes poverty away. When we include those who drink unsafe water from wells and springs, more than one-third of humanity lives in water poverty, the largest and most shameful failure of our civilization. Pipe water is not the solution for most. Solutions at the household are the only feasible path for most. The households in need are mostly spread out, many in rough terrain. Small well drilling methods are essential to access where the wells are needed. Groundwater is everywhere beneath us. It's in the fractures in the rock and in the pore spaces between the sand and gravel particles. And the water table in general is less than about 25 to 30 meters in most areas, so fresh groundwater is generally accessible. This is an example. Fresh groundwater is nearly everywhere. This is an ancient hand-dug well in the Gobi Desert that I noticed on a field trip many years ago. We got out of the vehicle, found a hand-dug well, and looked down, and the water table was at 2 meters, and the water is fresh, good water quality. These were wells were dug by nomads when camels were used for transportation. Much water poverty existed in America more than 100 years ago, as evidenced by hand pumps and people taking water out of dug wells by pails. Water poverty was eradicated from America by self-supply, initiated locally with lowest cost methods. This proved that enough fresh water for household wells exists nearly everywhere. Dug wells and manual wells drilled in America between the 1600s and right up through the 1940s. A dug well on the left in difficult conditions, but even if the aquifer is not very good, the well acts as a reservoir. And on the right, manual drilling. The proof of this are the records for 45 million hand pumps made in the United States between the 1600s and 1970. Manual well drilling is a self-supply step for household wells. Example on the left, Wisconsin in 1895, and on the right, a method invented in Bolivia by a German engineer in 2011. Africa. Studies indicate that there is enough fresh groundwater, not too deep, to supply household wells just about anywhere. And the orange area on this map, which is very small, is the only area where the well yields expected based on this mapping would not be sufficient. And in Africa, much of this fresh groundwater occurs in hard basement rock that requires rock drilling machines. Manual drilling can't go deep enough because of the hardness of the rock. And on the right, we see a view of the geology, where there are large chunks of rock that aren't weathered to become soft, and therefore to make a well, you have to get through those. Only 500 to 1,000 liters per day of safe water is needed to lift each family out of water poverty. Wells to supply this daily yield should be feasible just about anywhere if the appropriate well drilling methods and hydrogeological knowledge is used. Two examples of manual drilling, the EMAS method that I mentioned earlier, which is particularly versatile, but there's several other methods that are very useful. And then on the lower right, there's a high-tech method, manual, but made out of high-tech materials. This, the village drill invented in Utah in 2013. So one needs to be able to drill through the hard materials to get down to where the water is. However, manual drilling has limited possibilities to penetrate deep enough in the rock to access fresh water in the fractures. Therefore, machine drills are needed. On the left, there's an example of a small cable tool drill, the Rhino drill, developed by a rotary project in California and now constructed in a commercial manufacturing shop. It's rugged, easy to use, effective, but won't go through the hardest rock. And on the right, a mud rotary drilling machine made in Texas that is portable. Portable rock drills made for finding minerals offer greatest potential for water well drilling in hard rock. These machines take rock core, and that's why they're used all over the world for mineral exploration. And here we see some slides of field demonstrations using one of these drills. The smallest one is the Shaw drill, and the other one is the Winkie drill, both of which are being improved. Innovation is essential to move forward on these things. However, if you're drilling a small diameter hole, which is what these drills make, you need to have a method to create the seal that's innovative. Here we have on the left the Winkie drill making a hole, and in the middle we have a tube down into which a slurry of bentonite grout is being pumped into a container, a flexible container. And at the end, then, we end up with the borehole sealed with the grout inside the what we call a shroud. We're working on an alternative that would use the lowest cost water tubing, that black coiled pipe there, and then you would slip these bentonite swelling seal sleeves over it, as many as you would want, and then you would lower it down into the drill hole and let the water inflate the seal, and then you're done. This is an experimental being field tested. I recently became aware of an extremely innovative methodology. You can check it out on the website. An entirely new type of well drilling. The materials itself cost less than $500 for a drilling unit. It's an airlift reverse flow drilling method, roughly $400 per well, and the training needed to make it operate is relatively easy. Four methods need to be used synergistically at the family farm scale: small household wells, point of use water filters, rainwater harvesting, and deep bed farming, all of which allow great possibilities for the rural people in water poverty to greatly improve their lives. Tens of millions of household wells are needed to access groundwater that exists nearly everywhere. What are the obstacles? Knowledge and money for supported self-supply, and better understanding what are the best methods to drill wells in many circumstances. We need comparative field trials. Wells installed by manual drilling or small engine machines equipped with hand pumps cannot drain aquifers. That's not a threat to over-exploitation of aquifers in the world. Thank you for your attention. I'll be pleased to answer questions in the question period.
Yes, thank you very much, John Cherry, for your interesting presentation. Yeah, the presentation itself was recorded, but John will be available during the discussion for questions. So if you have any comment or question or something that struck you, please do share. And then during the discussion, we will come back to it. Next is a presentation from Colin Andrews from TNE. It's also recorded because he was not able to join in person today, but his colleague Alex Gerard, he's available, so he will be able to answer any questions. Colin Andrews is the chair of TNE, which is a charity in the UK. He's trained in estate management and following a career consultant advising landowners, Colin became a trustee of TNE in 2013, so about 10 years ago. He has led this organization to be a key partner, player in low-tech sustainable farming, which majors on soil protection and improvement, water conservation and management. And as part of the presentation, he will explain about the method applied by TNE and how it helps to store water and make it available for farming.
Hello, my name is Colin Andrews. I am the chair of a UK registered charity with an operational arm of Malawian trainers training Malawi families and farmers in Malawi. And the principal aims of improving our agriculture is inextricably linked to the training for them to become water managers. In Africa, we've got a number of challenges to rural livelihoods that most people are aware of. We have climate change with the resulting unexpected droughts in the middle of growing seasons particularly, and flooding. We also have soil fertility issues where the FAO identifies some 29 tons of topsoil is lost from every hectare every year. And when that soil is lost, of course, it is then deposited in a damaging way to the lowlands as silt. And then finally, the most important thing which these lead to, which is rural poverty, linked to a time when there's population growth and the hunger and as a result, the pressures on the World Food Programme are ever growing. And that vulnerability of those rural poor because of climate change and those other issues is what we seek to address. Typical examples, those pictures on your screen show you a typical flood. That village hasn't flooded before, but that was in 2021. And also the results of siltation destroyed crops. And the reason for that, why are we losing all this soil and all this water? Well, it isn't that erosion is the problem. Erosion is the result of poor farming and land management methods. This is the hidden enemy. Underneath the soil, just not very far down, perhaps 20 centimetres, perhaps less, is a hard pan caused by constant foot traffic, but more importantly, by the constant use of the mattock or African hoe, which year after year compresses the soil just below the surface so that water can't go through it and nor can roots of plants. And this contributes to many of our problems, but it really has only been known for 25 years or so in the wide scale of things. And Francis Jackson, OBE, who is a well-known world soil scientist, was sent by the FAO in 1999 with a team of people to discover to what extent hard pan existed in Malawi. And they were very surprised to find that not only did it exist ubiquitously all over the country, but also into all different sorts of soil, there was elements of hard pan or very serious hard pan. And the extrapolation of that is that the adjacent countries also suffer the same issues. In fact, countries all over the world suffer from compaction due to farming methods and the resultant damage to the environment from faster water runoff and also from ponding of water where it can't filter into the subsoil and top aquifers. So what we train farmers to do initially is to break the hard pan, which is on the left there. You can see great clods having broken the hard pan, having broken that impermeable layer. They are then ready to break that down and make it into deep beds. On the right-hand side, you see the collaborative work that our communities that request training from TNE have to do to create a contour line, a contour ridge exactly on the contour. If they're 1% out, it's 100 metres long, that's a 1 metre of water racing down the hillside. So these two pictures identify the solution to the problem, which is one, create the conditions so that percolation can take place, and two, stop water running downhill. This is how farmers become water managers, and they are at the very pinnacle of how water management can work and water catchment, because they're right up there in the hills where that rain first starts to fall and run downhill. If the water is all caught, as deep bed farms catch all the water that lands on their farms, if it's caught high up, that means it protects the farms below. If they catch it and so on down, then you have a cascading message to stop a cascade of water. And if that water moves fast, it will take the topsoil with it. It will take the family silver, that is the fertility of the soil for future generations of farmers. And in these two pictures, you can see the farmers working as water managers. There's a farmer in both of those. They're separate farms on a very rainy day, and they have captured a huge amount of water. And you will see, if you look carefully at the pictures, that already that water has started to percolate. In this picture, you can see the water actually, it is actually raining. You can see on the left-hand side those excellent beds created by Edward from Bongolo. And he's got lovely mulch on the beds so that there's not any surface pan being caused by rain hitting the soil hard from 3,000 feet up. But also the water has been collected. And on the right, you can see the water was collected and it's percolated into the subsoil, which is where we want it. It did not flow over the surface. It sat there and sank in. And that right-hand picture is important because you see a vetiver grass marker ridge exactly on the contour line. That vetiver grass, if ever that furrow filled full of water, that vetiver grass works as a sieve to allow the water to go through over it in the unlikely event of it filling up, but also stopping the soil from being washed through at the same time. Vetiver grass, really important to the deep bed method because it prevents a shock in the case of a very, very heavy rainstorm. And the result. So the agricultural result, that is the crop yield result, is really obvious. These two farms with one on each picture, the land is owned by the same farmer to the left and the right. One is his traditional method and two is the deep bed method. And I don't think I need to say any more. You look at those crops, you look at the colour, the size, and you see that deep bed farming is doing itself. What it's doing is it's accessing water below the hard pan, whereas on the left-hand side, the traditional farm, they haven't broken the hard pan. The roots can't get the micronutrients or the moisture necessary for their proper growth. But that's a deep bed farm you see there. That is, we've got higher, much greater crops. They get surpluses. That means there's going to be less need for food imports, less pressure on the world food program. But also the hidden benefit, they are recharging their aquifers. And those aquifers are important for their livelihoods and for the livelihoods of the country, the national livelihoods. So without a water supply, no farmer can really develop properly. They need water, they need it for their own domestic uses, but they also need it for a dry spell in the middle because of climate change in the middle of the growing season. They've got some water on tap, as it were, to put on their crops. The water supply needs to be much nearer the houses than the current village wells are, where they have to walk perhaps an hour, wait for half an hour in the queue and walk back. That waste of time is got rid of, and that time is then used very effectively. And this method of farming, it addresses key SDGs, and those top two are the poverty and hunger, and that is what we started by aiming at. But what we find is that because we're becoming water managers, that is our farmers are, there are a whole lot of other issues that are addressed. So lastly, we've been approached by CIWI, that's the Stockholm International Water Institute, who are linking with Tiara for a Zambezi-wide catchment pilot study. The idea is that Tieni, with its deep bed farming, will be used to deal with the water catchment high up and low down on smallholder farms. If the smallholder farms all do their stuff and percolation takes place well, then that's the first step in creating a healthy and managed water catchment. So the map is there, and you can see there are two areas in Malawi on the right-hand side where pilot studies are planned. So that's Tieni, that's deep bed farming. And of course, we thought it was just farming we were doing, but we realize now that the key element of being water managers as well makes those smallholder farmers absolutely fundamentally vital for the future of African farming and African rural livelihoods. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you to Tieni and to Colin for this, I think, very inspiring presentation. Before we continue to the presentation of Kickstart from Martin, there is one question in the chat, which I would like to pose to first to Alex and then maybe to John Cherry, for them to answer. The question from Alexander Gerner, or Gerner, is John Cherry showed a slide with infiltration of water from rainwater harvesting. Isn't there an issue with clogging? Is this infiltration of rainwater really effective on the mid or long term? So maybe Alex, if you would like to respond, and then John as well. Thank you.
Absolutely, yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, in isolation, you could argue that that long-term clogging could occur, but as you've just seen from our presentation, when you combine that with other land management processes, it's about keeping the soil once it has been broken up so the water can percolate. It's about making sure that there are natural processes to keep that percolation process active, and using integrated agriculture, agroforestry, that is extremely attainable. And that is what is happening with our deep bed farming method. By keeping the root systems active, they stop the hard pan from occurring again, and also the practice of reducing how compaction occurs through the actual agricultural process is critical. So yes, absolutely. And the more that methods of regenerative agriculture and improved land management occurs, rainwater management and harvesting is extremely effective and very scalable.
Yes, this is regenerative agriculture is what is needed to save the planet, period. Almost everything we humans have done in agriculture has made the soil less pervious, water runs off into the ocean and all of that. So this is really the key to everything, and is a micro example of what has to happen across the world in many other ways.
Thank you, John and Alex, for your contribution. And for participants, please keep contributing to the chat and the Q&A. As mentioned, the next presentation is from Martin Fischer of Kickstart, who is the co-founder and the CEO of Kickstart International. After receiving his PhD in mechanical engineering from Stanford in 1985, he went to Kenya on a Fulbright scholarship and stayed for over 17 years, working on clean water and sanitation. And in 1991, he co-founded Kickstart as a non-profit social enterprise with a mission to help millions of poor farmers make a lot of money. So thank you for being present, Martin, and the floor is yours to present.
Great,
your
thanks
work.
A lot. Let me share my screen here. I hope this works. Let's see if it does. Let me know if you can see it. Can you see my screen?
You just have to make it full screen. Then.
Yep, I'm doing that. There we go. Can you all see it? Great. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thank you.
And I'm going to talk about what we call farmer-led, which is really the same as self-supply for irrigation and household water. And I think the fact that we're using two different words demonstrates the major chasm between agriculture development and awash. And we really need to talk about the same thing, because they're farmer-led is what they talk about in agriculture. Self-supply is what we talk about for awash. But they're really the same. As we heard, Kickstart is a nonprofit social enterprise founded in Kenya in 1991 in a pretty simple mission. to enable millions of smallholders to earn a lot more money, climb out of poverty, and adapt to climate change. Of course, we know this, but 80% of the poorest in Africa are smallholder farmers. They get low yields, they have low incomes, they can't afford good inputs, and as a result, they're trapped in the cycle of poverty. And of course, climate change is making farming even harder when the rains don't come. But for millions of them, the best way to earn a lot more money and adapt to climate change is simply to move from rain-fed farming to irrigated farming. And the reasons are, with rain-fed farming, they generally grow low-value staple crops, they get one or two harvests per year, they flood the markets, they get low prices as a result. For some of these crops, up to 40% spoils before it's eaten or sold. And of course, if there's no rain, if the rain fails, they get no crop at all, or it gets washed away in a flood. With irrigation, you're generally growing high-value crops, fruits and vegetables, multiple harvests per year. In fact, you can harvest every day and sell year-round. And especially in the off-seasons when the prices are high, and that's the hungry season, and you get sell right at the farm gate. And of course, if the rains fail, you can save your crops, and you can replant quickly after a flood. So really moving from low-value subsistence farms into highly profitable family farms if you move to irrigation. It's got huge benefits, and across Asia, over 40% of farmland is irrigated, over 52% in India. Sub-Saharan Africa, only 4% of farmland is irrigated, and that's mainly in South Africa, Sudan, and Madagascar. Madagascar is not even on my map here. And as a result, you get these annual hungry seasons and very little ability to adapt to climate change for the farmers. Sub-Saharan Africa has plentiful water resources. We saw a bit of this. There's a lot of rivers, lakes, and streams, and springs, and a lot of shallow aquifers where you can reach the water with hand-dug wells or hand-drilled tube wells. In fact, Sub-Saharan Africa is using less than 10% of its renewable groundwater and less than 5% of its renewable surface water. And something like 20% of farmers actually have surface or shallow groundwater right on their farms. And for the others who don't, they can dig water catchments, anything from an informal hole in the ground, if you're lucky enough to have a good clay that seals the soil, or otherwise with a liner you can see down on the left side there. So irrigation is a solution for millions, but there's very limited history, very limited knowledge, and limited rural access to grid electricity or fuel for pumping. So really, there were no affordable irrigation technologies for smallholders. And this is what Kickstart set out to solve by designing and promoting very low-cost human-powered irrigation pumps. We call them moneymaker because, frankly, if you're poor, your number one need is a way to make a lot more money. And these pumps are designed in Kenya and designed and tested with men and women farmers with very, very stringent design criteria. They have to be highly affordable, cost recovery in one harvest in 3 to 4 months. Obviously very strong and durable, have to be gender friendly to use. Women have to be able to use these things. Very easy to install and use and maintain without training or tools. And of course we need water efficient irrigation, pressurized hose pipe irrigation, nozzles and sprinklers, and high energy efficiency. We need a lot of water with very little effort. So these are our design criteria. Our best selling pump by far is this little treadle pump, little like a take-home Stairmaster. You step back and forth, you can pull water out of a well, push it through a hose pipe under pressure. And this retails across Africa at about $190, including the hose pipes and spares. People are using it to irrigate even over 2 acres of land. That's a lot of money. So we introduced something called the hip pump. It looks like a hand pump, but actually it's pivoted on a pivot there. So you rock back and forth to operate it. And it retails about $120 with hose pipes and spares in local shops. People are irrigating up to 1.25 acre with this. And just this year, we've now introduced something we call the starter pump. It's similar to the hip pump, but substantially cheaper, retailing for under $80 with hose pipes and spares, irrigating up to a little over 3/4 acre. Farmers are using it, and you can see it's driving a sprinkler there. Now, all of these can pull water from a 7 meter depth. They can lift water a total head of 14 meters, or they can push water for even 150 meters on flat ground. It's human powered, but it's easy to use, very, very efficient, and also very efficient hose pipe or sprinkler irrigation. So it doesn't use a lot of water. And coming in 23, 24, people are talking about solar pumps. They're generally very expensive. We're some of the people working on a lower cost solar pump along with others, targeting about 250, including all of the components, retail price in the local shop. Now, we very much believe in the private sector being the key player, and so we established private sector supply chains across Sub-Saharan Africa. Now, we do mass produce these pumps in China, and the reason for that is it's easier to ship from China than it is to ship around Africa. It's a sad truth. And then we're sold to important distributors with retail shop networks all across sub-Saharan Africa. For example, in Kenya, we have two importers and over 40 retail shops selling the products. And we have hundreds of distributors and retailers across other countries, creating a sustainable local supply for the pumps, the spares, and the accessories in your local shop. And something like 50% of these sales are direct to individual farmers when we're talking about farmer-led or self-supply. And then we partner with anyone who's working with thousands of farmers, with all the biggest NGOs, UN and government agencies, microfinance organizations, agribusinesses, to introduce and promote irrigation. Because there's a lot of behavior change, a lot of education that has to happen, and these organizations already work with farmers. We have over 300 partners using our MoneyMaker pumps in their programs already. We teach them about irrigation. We teach the farmers about irrigation. We also train them in what we call agripreneurship. And we do this through a network of partnership and promotion officers doing farm demos, field demos, exhibits and shows. We do radio, TV promotions. And this agripreneurship is really teaching them how to make farming a commercial business. If you look at that picture on the bottom right, both of those fields are irrigated, but you can see one is much more productive than the other. So it's not just irrigation, but already you get most of the benefit just from irrigation, but then you can do better. And we're also now digitizing some of that training as we're moving into ways that we can spread it more quickly. We've also got occasionally working on small bore tube well drilling. And this is for soils with no hard rocks or water, primarily in floodplains, where you have a layer of soft soils, clay, silt, and then you have an aquifer with sand and water down at some level. And you can see that drill, it's only 32 millimeters in diameter, 1.25 inches, very, very small, very easy to drill down. You drill down a hole into the aquifer, you put down a hose pipe, you take one of our pumps, which we call a mud or sand pump, and then you pump out the sand from the aquifer, creating a water storage capacity cavity inside the aquifer and a pile of sand up top. Once you've done that, you then replace it with your clear water pump, and you can see you now have your well. Here's an example. There's a woman here, and you can see the well, that little tiny hole in the ground on the right where the hose comes out, that's now the tube well. And this particular woman is actually providing free water to 50 families who come up every day and line up to get their jerry cans filled. And you can see all the clothes hanging out back. They come to do their laundry there too. Now, is this water clean? Well, it's a sealed tube well. We train the drillers to drill far away from latrines. So effectively, it's pretty clean water. Now, it could be tested, but the vast majority of hand dug wells only have this kind of cleanliness. And of course, it is sealed at the top because it's such a small diameter well. We work in 17 highest potential countries across sub-Saharan Africa there. You can see we have headquarters in Nairobi in Kenya, which is where we do all our technology development. And we have hubs there in Nigeria and Zambia. We've been working, like I said, promoting pumps since about 2000. Now, we are a nonprofit. We do a lot of promotion. We use donor funds there before we have to measure our impacts. But on average, these farmers are making $700 in new profits per year when they move from rain-fed to irrigated farming with these pumps. And most importantly, they have year-round crops and income, and they pay for food and education. They adapt to climate change. They start new on-farm and off-farm businesses with those incomes, and in general get about 4 times family net farm income as a result. For the first time, these families have money to plan for the future and take a major step out of poverty. And we've seen this time and time again. Since 1999, we've sold over 380,000 of these pumps. Over 100,000 of those are in Kenya, where we started. About 80,000 highly profitable farming businesses, 230,000 local jobs created, $200 million per year in new profits and wages are being earned by these farmers. 1.4 million people have taken a major step out of poverty, and 14 million people are fed with the fruits and vegetables from these pumps. So it's a drop in the bucket for Africa, but we need these kind of numbers, and we need these kind of numbers to be multiplied by factors of 10 and 100. But there's huge impacts. Sustainable livelihoods, I've really shown how that happens. But what are the wash impacts? Well, first one is easier access to household water. You use the income from the irrigation to cover the cost of digging the well and your pump. And then you have more household water. It means you're going to get improved hygiene because you have enough water for good washing. You can afford to treat drinking water. You can afford to buy a filter. You can afford to buy tablets. You can afford to boil your water. And of course, you can also afford to build an improved pit latrine or sanitation. So once people have money, they get better hygiene and better wash outcomes. Improved food security, of course, nutrition and health. We have randomized controlled trials that show massively reduced stunting in kids. Empowering women and girls. We have, again, randomized controlled trials that show improved mental health, less marital violence, less risky sexual behavior by teenagers in these families. Resilience to climate change, of course. Environmental protection, minimal water usage because it's human-powered, water-efficient hose pipe irrigation. We use renewable ground and surface water, and you get greenery year-round. And today, I think our farmers have already planted well over 14 million trees with these pumps and are planting every day. So huge environmental impacts as well. But Sub-Saharan Africa needs to reach 20% irrigated if it wants to feed itself, create millions of livelihoods, and survive climate change. The population is going to reach 4 billion people. It's 1.1 billion today. It's going to reach 4 billion people by 2100. And we have to have irrigation as a major part of that solution. So Kickstart is working to catalyze smallholder irrigation, innovate the new technologies and methods required for millions to irrigate, the tools, the education, but also the financing method. We pilot new financing methods so that poor farmers can afford irrigation. We widely promote and distribute these new innovations working through partnerships and private sector supply chains. So we have a sustainable supply chain and partners to reach farmers. And we advocate to catalyze system changes. The policies, the funding, the subsidies need to be put in place that support rapid uptake of farm-led irrigation. For example, in Rwanda, our pumps are 50% subsidized by the government. So that $80 pump is going to be retailing there at $40. And to do all this, we have to massively collaborate and partner to maximize the impacts. We all have to work together, and that's how Kickstart works. And thank you so much. And we're happy if you can join us to irrigate Africa and, of course, have huge wash impacts at the same time. Thank you.
Yes, Martin, thank you very much for your very lively and inspiring presentation. I think there's a few questions in the chat, which you also might have seen. So I think it will be nice if you can respond to them. Maybe one I wanted to highlight, maybe you can already respond to now, is from Auke Itzinga. He says there's a difference in treadle pumps in Africa and the Philippines. In Africa, it gives the user a status, but it's the other way around in the Philippines. Is it something you recognize, or have Absolutely. You come across it giving status in Africa?
Well, let me say that a lot of people in the donor community feel that somehow treadle pumps and human powered pumps are very kind, are really putting people down. But the reality is the other option is using a bucket and a rope, which is much, much more work and much harder to do, or suffering away in poverty. But actually the individuals, and I just got back from the field, 2 weeks in the field, talking to farmers every day, I didn't find a single farmer who felt that using this pump was making them any less viable as a human being. In fact, they all were very proud. They gained status. We have a lot of studies to prove that women using these pumps gain community status, gain family status. So we don't see that as a big problem. But it obviously depends on the level of poverty. There's some parts of Kenya which feel that they're a bit richer, and they are a bit richer, where we don't sell as many pumps. But it's a good question.
I was muted. Thank you, Martin, for responding. Now we'll move on to the last presentation before we have the discussion. The last presentation will be by Henk Holtzlag about supporting self-supply, an innovative approach to reach SDG 6.1 in rural Africa. Henk has over 3 decades of experience in rural water supply projects, mostly with failures, but also some successes. He co-initiated the Smart Center concept and is senior advisor of the MetaMeta Smart Center Group. There are smart centers in 9 different countries in Africa and 1 in Nicaragua. And these centers train entrepreneurs in local production of innovative low-cost wash technologies. So I will share the slides, and the floor is yours, Henk.
Okay, thank you. If you can open the video also, Rainier.
For you, yes.
Then I don't speak from the dark.
Yes, now we see you.
You see me? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so this idea is to serve the 300 million people that lack basic service. So using self-supply as a tool to serve these people. Next, please. Because as you can see, if you want to reach the rural poor, which often live in areas with very few people, the cost per capita, so the cost per person, is very high. It's basically impossible and too expensive to serve these 3 million people with pipe systems or machine-built boreholes. And you can see this on the graph that was made by UNICEF, and it's published in the book of self-supply mentioned by Matthias and made by Sarisato. Next, please. So a common option for rural water supply in Africa is a machine-built borehole and an imported hand pump. And these systems are subsidized. They cost about $2,000 to $8,000. And if you calculate the cost per capita for 200 people, that is $25. Now, if you would use the same technology for 50 people, the cost per person would be $100. So next slide, please. So a solution for small communities is hand-drilled boreholes and locally produced pumps. And for instance, you have seen the pictures of the drilling and the rope pump, and a system like that in Zambia costs $1,000. And on average is used by 40 people. So the cost per person is exactly the same as for the communal supply, which is about $25. And the cost can be so low because for small communities, you can have smaller wells. And there's millions of hand-drilled wells in Asia, and there's over 200,000 in Africa, especially in Nigeria. And the drilling options include rotary jetting, Shipo drill, Emmas drill, Phillips drill. And these are all technologies that can drill in semi-hard layers. But if there is rocks, you need mechanized drills, as mentioned by John Cherry. Now, examples of low-cost pumps are treadle pumps, rope pumps and MS pumps, and we are starting also with small cost solar pumps. Next slide, please. So the challenge again in Sub-Saharan Africa, how do we reach the SDG 6.1? How do we reach the yet unserved, the people that are left behind? And it is a proposition, and I would like your opinion. The proposition is to provide basic service to these 300 million people. It is more cost effective to subsidize self-supply, so family wells and farm wells, than to subsidize communal wells. So if you agree with this proposition, put an agree in the chat box. If you don't agree, put it also. Next slide. So smart supply or self-supply can scale up with smart tech, so-called smart tech. And smart tech is an abbreviation for simple, market-based, affordable, repairable technologies. And these low-cost technologies are part of what we call a smart approach. And the smart approach focuses on first the innovation, so the low-cost technology that can be produced locally, with the advantage that there are also local spare parts and local skills. The number two focus of this smart approach is training. So train well drillers, pump producers, because we have learned the hard way that although a rope pump is simple, simple is not easy. You need long-term coaching to guarantee quality and to improve the business skills. And the third focus of the smart approach is supporting self-supply. So stimulate families to invest themselves. And the families that already have basic supply, they should find payment options to invest. But this approach is for the families who do not have basic self-supply. So the target group of SDG 6, and they need a subsidy. It's an illusion that the poorest in rural areas can pay themselves. And this smart approach was evaluated last year by IRC with the main conclusion that this approach has much potential to reach water-related development goals. Next, please. So there is many technology that are fit for self-supply. For wells, you can upgrade existing wells with a well cover and a pump. For pumps, you have MS and rope pumps and treadle pumps. And as I mentioned, there's also new solar pumps that cost a range of $150 to $300. An option for storage is an MS underground tank that stores 7,000 liters for $150. The D-bed farming, as mentioned by Tieni, is a huge potential to store water in ground in shallow aquifers, not in the deep ones, but in the shallow ones. And for treatment, there is locally produced pot and biosand filters and high quality filters that are also produced locally. As examples are Nazafa and Tulip filters. And the lowest option started at a cost of $22 in these countries. So in summary, in areas where there is more than 200 millimeters of rain per year, you can basically have a basic service for $25 per person with a combination of all these technologies. So the example is Zambia. Via the Yakana Smart Center, some 460 subsidized wells were installed at a cost of $1,000 per well. And these wells are installed at a family, not at a community, but in a family. But the condition for the subsidy is income. They have to generate income. That's the condition. That's the only condition. And with this income, the families can pay maintenance, which for a rope pump is maybe $30 a year. And the results are impressive. The results are that on average, every well serves 40 people for domestic use. We thought that people would start selling water, but they don't. People in Zambia share water. They share with the neighbors. They give it for free, and sometimes neighbors pay with an extra bucket of water pumping or the chicken, but the people don't pay for the water, and pump is still functioning. And so over 90% of the pumps are functioning, and that is a result. Another result of this approach is that we create the demand for unsubsidized self-supply, so for 100% self-supply. So there's already over 130 families that 100% pay themselves. And we have seen the same development in Tanzania. There is over 15,000 rope pumps now, and most of them are paid for by the families. So in short, the effect of supporting self-supply is that you get 5 SDGs for the price of 1. You get SDG 1, 6-1, which is water, but you also get, for the family that has the well, the SDG 1 and 2. Irrigation, I don't need to explain, it was done by the Kickstart example so much. Water for a farmer means income. People get out of poverty if they get water. An example is Nicaragua, where there's 50,000 rope pumps now on farm wells, and a study indicated there that by shifting from a rope in a bucket to a pump increased the income by $220 a year. So if you look on the long term, it is over $100 million a year. And that was the result of just $2 million of aid money. So investing $2 million of aid, the impact is over $100 million. And the money maker have even much bigger numbers. Another SDG is gender. If you have a well at premises, the women don't need to collect it from far away sources. And there's more safety for women and girls. And the last one is producing wells and pumps and irrigation. It all creates jobs. So again, for the price of 1, you get 5 SDGs as compared with the conventional approach. So self-supply has potential, but it also has concerns, of course. The first one is, as was mentioned already, is what about the quality? Are shallow wells fit for drinking? And another one is, if we drill millions of wells, what about the groundwater? So maybe it's simple, but in this case, it is simple. Water quality does not be a problem, does not need to be a problem if you use a household water treatment, a filter or chlorine or boiling, but a filter in general is good enough. And where the groundwater has chemicals, you can use a rainwater storage tank and you combine it with filters. And as for depletion, the examples of depletion from India are because there's large scale irrigation. For Africa, in this case, it is not about large scale irrigation, it's for household irrigation with a hand pump. And with a hand pump, I invite you to deplete the groundwater level with a hand pump. But in general, it's not the case. And especially not if we combine it with maximum rainwater harvesting. So in conclusion, that supporting self-supply and farm wells is a strong tool to reach the water and food related development goals. And the cost of reaching this goal in rural sub-Saharan Africa is $25 per person. And that is much cheaper than the conventional approach and much cheaper than the cost that was mentioned in all the sessions. I'm in New York. And yesterday it was mentioned again that we need 40 billion to reach the SDG 6. We think that you can do this in Africa, at least, with a much lower cost. So some recommendations. We think that to reach SDG 6 in Africa, we need to transform. We need transformation from imported technologies to also local technologies, from water for domestic use to also water for productive use, and from subsidizing communal wells to also subsidize farm wells or household wells for the target group of SDG 6. And we can use the examples from Zambia and Tanzania and Kenya. Another recommendation is rural development hubs. So hubs where we collect all best practices and all knowledge for agriculture and for water. So people, organizations, government can go there and get the best, most cost-effective options. And one positive thing that I saw in the UN conference yesterday was that several presenters say we need to combine WASH and agriculture because together we can reach many SDGs. And so the last question, who will pay? What does it cost and who will pay? So if we have 300 million times 25, it's only $7.5 billion. And whether it's 7.5 or 8 or 10, it's still very little compared to the conventional approach. And who could or should pay? Well, everyone that is interested in getting water for all, but also person and the NGOs, the governments that want to reduce poverty, that want to promote gender, they want to create employment, they want to build climate resilience. And another potential source is carbon credits. Thank you very much, and more information on the slide. Thank you.
Thank you, Henk, for your presentation. Of course, yeah, for me, it's not new, but I do think it has some very inspiring examples, and I hope that among the participants, it also makes the concept of self-supply clear, but also how give some thought on how it could work in your own country, because I think the participants are from quite a wide variety of backgrounds. Now, this was the last presentation, so we will continue with the moderated discussion now, based on the questions which were asked in the chat and the Q&A. And for that, I would like to invite Sabina to to moderate the questions and the answers. And thank you very much for being available.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Rania. So I'm Sabina. I'll be with you for next 20 to 25 minutes. And we'll be talking about the sessions that we already had and the questions we had on the session. What a session. Like, it was a wonderful, insightful session, even for beginners in the audience here. And so much potential, self-supply with so much potential and such a simple approach towards solving the global crisis in terms of water, in terms of climate, but yet overlooked, so much overlooked. And this raises a lot of questions on identifying the importance of self-supply and why it is yet not prioritized. So with that said, please allow me to move on to our Q&A round. So as we have our recognized author in audience and we have a question from herself, it's a question from Sally Sutton and it is directed to Mr. Martin Fisher. So the question goes something like this. Kickstart pumps have achieved enormous impact. To what degree is it possible to see this as a springboard? People being able to move on to diesel pumps or solar? And the follow-up question is, when does small investment begin to threaten groundwater availability for all?
Great. Well, I'll be very happy to answer that for Sally. And it's a very good question. And absolutely, we're seeing more and more of our farmers who start with a human-powered pump now being able to upgrade to solar or diesel pumps. Preferably solar is what we prefer, but solar pumps are still fairly expensive. Nonetheless, we have hundreds and hundreds of farmers who have started with one of our pumps and upgraded to solar. One of the disadvantages of solar to keep in mind is that it doesn't work when there's no sun, and there's many cloudy days when you still need to irrigate. And so what we found is somebody starts with a human-powered pump, they step up to solar, they go back to the human-powered pump when the sun's not shining. And I've visited many, many farmers who are using those two systems together. Now, of course, our pumps only are for shallow wells. They are suction pumps, while a solar pump can pump from much deeper. So absolutely, it's a useful step up. And in fact, we push farmers to do that. We're introducing now a rent to try and buy program where a farmer can actually rent a pump. And we're seeing farmers paying as much as $5 a day to rent our pumps from agents, between $3 and $5 a day. And we know that within one season of renting a pump, they can make enough money to buy their own pump, even buy their own solar pump. And they maybe rent it 2 days a week, but they're making so much money from irrigation, they can afford that.
Thank you. Thank you. So, yeah, I hope that answers the second question as well. When does a small investment begin to threaten the groundwater availability for all? Yeah, so thank you again. With that, I would like to move on to, would you choose to answer all the questions? Because many questions are directed to you, Professor Fisher. So, yeah. So,
I see some more in the Q&A talk to.
Okay.
So you're talking about, there's a question here from Dries about solar pumps finance in a rent-to-own program.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're seeing more and more of this happen, but there's a challenge with rent-to-own, and we've done our own tests with solar rent-to-own for hundreds of pumps. And there's different ways to do rent to own. There's some ways you only pay when you're using water. So you only pay when you're pumping water. So that means some people might take 2 years to pay. Other people might pay within one season. But it's very hard to finance that kind of thing. But also we found that when we do it that way, where a farmer literally only pays when the pump is in use, they underwater because they're so aware that they're paying for every drop that they own underwater, they minimize their impact. The other way that rent to buy like that with a pay-as-you-go is where basically they have to finish the payment within a fixed amount of time. So in that case, maybe they have to pay off the loan within 1 year. And what we found there is there's massive defaults in the rainy season because of course in the rainy season, they don't need the pump, so they don't pay. And then it's very hard for them to catch up. So again, it becomes hard to finance. One of the things people are doing for the expensive solar pumps is they're bundling with the television or lights. Because we know people are much more likely to pay if their lights go out in the rainy season or if the TV goes off. But this is really for wealthy farmers. And so there isn't a good, really a pay-as-you-go program for very low-cost pumps. yet. And then also solar pumps still are too expensive. And that's why both Hank and I talked about the sort of $250, $150 solar pump. There's a huge need for that.
And there's last one from
Matthias. Yeah, in terms of constructing treadle pumps in Africa, we did that. I spent 15 years of my life proving precisely we could do that. We started in small workshops in Kenya. We went to larger workshops. We went to the biggest factories in Kenya to mass produce them. We went to Tanzania to mass produce them. And it worked. It was a lot of work. It's difficult. The raw materials are not consistent, not good quality, but we figured out ways to produce them. It's not easy to make a good pump. I just want to say that. It's not something you can easily copy. People have tried to copy. So many people have tried to copy. These pumps always fail. Nonetheless, you can do it. But what we found is the minute we wanted to ship a pump, even from Kenya to Malawi or Kenya to Mozambique, it was much cheaper to ship from China to Mozambique or Malawi than it was from Kenya, because there's no transport that goes between countries. And from, of course, shipping from Kenya to Nigeria, impossible. So actually, the reason we went to China is because now we can ship very cheaply all across Africa. It's unfortunate we had to do that, but it's not that we couldn't manufacture in Africa. It's just it would have had to be done in virtually every country. And that was a huge expense and cost to get the quality, get the training done to do that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Fisher. Now we move on to Matthias. So yeah, we have a question here, like what is, from your experience in Asia and Latin America, that what could be the key to upscale the self-supply in sub-Saharan and sub-Saharan Africa context? So how has the experience been, Mr. Saladin, Matthias Saladin?
Yes. Yeah, that's a tricky question you're posing there. How to get self-supply right? It's been mentioned in the chat box. You need to get many things right. And that's probably one of the reasons why some organizations shy away. It's not just sitting in a room designing your perfect village well and then putting it all over the world. You really need to understand context. You need to work with the context. You need to make markets work. So, for example, someone mentioned pricing. It's key to get the price right. Otherwise, there's no market. It's also key to have spare parts. Otherwise, as soon as the first part is broken, it's the end of the pump. So it's really a lot of things that need to work together. And it's about the local supply chains and local value chains. If you can make those work, then it will go to scale. But as mentioned, that's not easy to do. And many people watch to Asia, comparing to Africa, and many of the conditions are quite different. The water is at much lower levels usually. There's less groundwater available in Africa, at least in many places I know. There's less population density, and that's key for market development. So it's a bit hard of a comparison, but there are sufficient examples of showing it can work also in Africa if you get the ingredients right. That's my answer to that one. Thanks.
Thank you. So I come from Nepal, and I can totally imagine that the technology that is applicable in Nepal would not be directly applicable in Africa for many reasons. So thank you very much, Mr. Saladin.
Maybe I can touch on the question around solar pumps depleting aquifers. I think this is a very good question. Obviously, we know that what happened in India is we had petrol pumps which depleted aquifers. They were running 24/7, highly subsidized, or even free petrol in the rural areas with those pumps, and the aquifers have been completely defeated. Now what they're doing in India is they have very large solar pumps that they're putting in place, which are not going to go 24/7, but going to go 8 or 9 hours a day pumping water basically for free again. There's a very big difference in what we're doing with smallholders in Africa, is that in Africa, if you leave a solar panel in the field, it's going to get stolen. You have to be able to carry it and store it in your house. You're also very unlikely to want to be pumping right next to your house, because the place where the water is going to be a little bit away from your house. So a portable solar pump means you have to carry the panel. If you're carrying a panel of much bigger than 120 or 200 watts is very challenging. And at 120, 200 watts, since the pumps are not that efficient, electric pumps are only about 40, 50% efficient maximum, usually about 35, 40% efficient. It actually, you don't get all that much water from it. So you still need very efficient irrigation. And a human pump is about, you put in about 100 watts. Now human pumps are more efficient. We're more like 80% efficient instead of about 30 or 40% efficient. So actually, even to compete with a human with a portable solar is a challenge. But as long as they're portable, as long as they're small scale solar, they're not going to deplete aquifers.
Thank you. I can add to that. I had an irrigation project working on, and somebody just played around and broke it, and it was, the whole unit was non-functional. So that is also one of the part of working with solar. So yeah, and with that, I would like to move on to the next question to Professor Cherry. So as you mentioned about a million wells, and you are talking about different terrains. So what are the challenges? What are the challenges pertaining to the groundwater for self-supply in extreme terrains, for example, mountains? So Professor Cherry, the question is directed.
Well, as I mentioned, in the mountains, the people are getting the water from springs. And the problem with that, in many cases, the springs aren't located where you'd want to have them. The village, and also most springs are contaminated with fecal matter. So, I mean, either it's a point of use of filtering or it's wells. And that's what I started off on 20 years ago after seeing people in the mountains in China. And so with these new improved lightweight portable drills, that's the whole hope. And the water is at the spring, but you shouldn't have to drill very deep in order to tap in below where the contamination is. So my vision in many cases is these small rock drills need to be taken up into the mountains and used to make a flowing, and the wells then will be flowing. So it's a matter of making a hole, getting a hole down below where the contamination is, sealing it, and then just letting the water flow out, and it can then be distributed by pipe and other means. I'm not sure if that answers the questions, but that's the vision that I've been working on.
Sure. Thank you. So it comes with the terrain. Thank you, Professor Jerry. Now we move on to next question by Matthias Ulrich, and it is directed to Alex. Alex Derard, it's for TNE, and you are our TNE representative here today. The question is, agroforestry is an approach. So that's a question mark. And I think you want more answer on, for example, replant trees and protect by government to protect against mud avalanches. What we have seen in southern Malawi. So he's sharing an example and he's having a question on agroforestry could be approach or not, or something like that. Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, the whole approach really now is looking at a regenerative agriculture. To readdress the balance on land. We're adopting far more a catchment management approach to how we're looking at going forward with our work in TNE. Agroforestry is a key component of that. Not only does it help as a physical barrier, it also, as we mentioned earlier, keeps the root systems active. Trees and shrubs are very, very important for keeping the hard pan from redeveloping. And also for keeping the soil microbes active. So there's not one simple solution. It's about using multiple approaches. With ours, it's about getting the land active and proactive again and resilient, but integrating that with tree planting, agroforestry, and other element, other mitigating processes. In fact, last year after Storm Anna, which was came around the similar time of year as Cyclone Freddy this year, a lot of our deep-fed farmers reported that they lost less crop than their neighbors due to the resilience of the land through the integrated approach, and by the fact that deep-bed farming and regenerative agriculture as a whole tries to keep land producing and active. After all, if you think about it, soil shouldn't really see the sky. You know, soil is there to grow something. And what we've done globally is taken away a lot of the processes that allow that soil to be productive. So it is very much about giving more resilience to the land. There will be another storm like Freddy next year, without a doubt. It hit the same areas as last year. So it is now about looking at how can we make land far more resilient and far quicker. But you know, all things around regenerative agriculture also slow down the process of water when it hits You know, it comes from thousands of meters up when it hits the ground, and a lot of it just washes off, taking away soil. Whereas what we should be doing is harvesting it and storing it there, but also slowing it down, how it gets into the greater catchment, and slowing those processes. So yeah, agroforestry is absolutely part of what we do, and an integral part of the regenerative agricultural approach.
Yeah, thank you. So building up on what you just mentioned on soil and other aspects, so what has been the experience at TNE of the contribution of recharge through deep bed farming and the availability of water for wells using the groundwater? When we talk about integrated impact of the project, yeah.
Well, actually, it's an area that we're just really starting to study, and working with our partners like Meta, we want to really start addressing that. As Colin mentioned in our approach, you know, when we started doing deep bed farming, we hadn't fully appreciated the huge potential of deep bed farming for recharging shallow aquifers. But it is a critical part, is harvesting at source. So we know that a lot of our farmers have looked at borehole wells and seen that and measured anecdotally mainly that the water levels have gone down in the region. What we want to start looking at is actually how that is improving it. We know it is happening. The simple reason that you stand in a field where the water is not, the soil is not protected, it rushes off that land and it goes down roads. That's why roads always look brown and muddy, because they're full of mud and lovely soil. Whereas, you know, we can see from the pictures you saw, we see that all year, that when it lands on our deep bed farmland, it's sitting there and it's soaking into the ground. So we know it is recharging, but what we want to do now is do some real definitive work on assessing the before and after impact of a deep bed farming intervention. And, you know, it sits so hand in hand with hand pump and family irrigation, supply, because if the water isn't there, it can't be pumped out. And then people are trying to pump it from further away. In Malawi, people will farm, you know, will pump out of Lake Malawi and other rivers, and we need to be avoiding that as well. And so by just using an integration of a farming technique that harvests water, allows for those shallow aquifers to be available for local irrigation, and crucially also for use in homes and communities.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the question. So before we move on to Mr. Henk, we have one more question for Mr. Fisher here. So I don't think we want to miss that. So so it's again, we are getting back to you, Mr. Fisher here. So we saw the impactful numbers with more than millions living out of poverty with Kickstart. So the question is, how do you envision next the Kickstart giving the better visibility to the concept of self-supply and breaking the barriers in relation to self-supply? So what are the way forward through Kickstart?
Sorry, Martin, you are muted now, so you'll have to repeat the first sentence.
Hi, sorry. Yeah, thanks for the question. Yeah, I mean, I think, like I said in my opening slide, with agriculture, we call it farmer-led. With WASH, we're calling it self-supply. It's really the same thing. And we are all about self-supply, because these farmers are going out, they can get the pumps in their local retail shops, they can get the spare parts in their local retail shops. And like I say, about half the pumps are bought by individual farmers. But we also work with all these other agencies from the World Food Program, FAO, World Vision, Save the Children, all the biggest NGOs use our pumps in their programs. Now, many of them do give them out for free or with some kind of partial subsidy or on microfinance. So there's many, many different ways that the farmers can get these. Where we are now is we need a huge amount more awareness. We need millions and millions of farmers to understand that there are these low-cost solutions, all the ones we've seen about today, not only Kickstart pumps, and that they can access water right on their farm and they can have a low-cost pump and get the water out and use it. So we sort of feel that the key thing now is really about scaling. The reason we stick to agriculture is because we know you make a lot of money, and you can, of course, therefore easily pay for the well and pay for the pump as a result. And then you also get out of poverty. And then, you know, like I said, you can then buy the things you need to have clean water and sanitation and everything else. And we've seen this time and again. We have health studies, we have stunting studies to prove that. In my mind, the technologies are there. What we need now is massive scale up. Now, yeah, of course, we still need some more work. And I think, you know, what John's talking about for drilling through hard rock, absolutely, we need to take that technology and get it down to be affordable and then spread it and get a lot of well drillers out there doing it. So there's a lot of work to do. Certainly in sub-Saharan Africa, the impacts are so big for farmers that it sort of drives itself in terms of the reason that we're doing it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your answer. And then we move on to our way forward question. So it's directed to Mr. Henk now. So as you just said that $25 per person and with such high potential to solve the global water crisis, you said with 5 SDGs, and this is one solution which can address 5 different SDGs. So what do you think, or what do you identify as the starting point to work towards meeting that target of 1 million wells? How can we solve that? How can we start? What could be the potential starting point to meet that target, Mr. Henk?
Yeah, good question. I think the starting point is very basic. It's justice. Everyone that has water in the world was subsidized somewhere or the other. The people that do not yet have water don't have water because they don't have the right technologies. So the least we can do as developed countries is do justice and subsidize the poorest with the same subsidy as the ones who already have subsidized well. So that's the starting point. If we agree on that, then the next thing is, and do it with all these tools that we just saw in the presentation. There's a range of options. And with this combination, we challenge everyone to come up with situation where we cannot give basic service for $25 per person. I challenge everyone in the chat box, in this group, to come up with situations where we have rainwater of 200 millimeters a year, and we cannot give basic service for $25 per person. We can. We have proven it. And maybe in some places it is 35 or 50, and in other places it's 10. But on average, we can deliver for $25 per person basic service. That's the bottom line. Combine it with water filters, we have safe water. And so it's just a matter of doing it.
Indeed, Mr. Henk. Thank you very much for the question. So you directed to the fact that the policy stakeholders, that the stakeholders who are on policy level who can actually make that impact should be aware that it's a basic and fundamental right. And I hope the output from this particular discussion will be discussed further with the policy stakeholders in the sub-Saharan Africa or elsewhere where it is relevant. And I think that's where this discussion becomes fruitful. And with that, I would like to thank every speaker here. It was indeed insightful. And there is so much to do ahead. And with that said, I would like to conclude our discussion session and thank all the speakers. And I would like to hand it over to Rainier.
Yes, thank you, Sabina, for moderating the interactive discussion and bringing all the different questions to the right person. And, thanks to all for the questions, but especially the answers. As mentioned before, we have recorded the session, so it will be made available on the website of the Smart Center Group, as well as the individual presentations. And I think it's also an encouragement to stay in touch with each other for those present in New York, or those who can reach out virtually or online through email, etc., and to together work towards this goal, which Henk has laid out, but I think we have all laid out. Thank you very much for your interest, and looking forward to stay in touch with everyone. And wishing you a good remainder of the day. Thank you.
Thank you. And please do reach out to Henk and me and anybody else who's in New York if you're in New York and you'd like to talk to us. And I think John is here too. So it'd be great if we can have some meetings today or tomorrow. Just let us know on email.
Agree.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rainier and Sabina, for moderating.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Take care. Thank you.
Great to see you all. Thanks a lot. Great.